Somebody want to interpret? Bokesh te pekanate poro maste piki. And umbrodast. And berete finala. Now look, you can't just close your eyes during things that's going to happen. Because see, that's just, it doesn't work that way. You either there or you not there. That's just the way it is. And that's the point I want to make. Father wants you just to be in that realm. It's a realm that he's given us a privilege to live in, where the Holy Ghost has come to live in us and he's come to be with us. That there is a baptismal glory of his presence in our life, to where that we're the temple of the living God. And just imagine what's going to happen when you, as God's people, begin to recognize yourself as something so sacred. And you go back in the Bible and the Old Testament and begin to read about the temple. Look at how Jesus responded to the temple, even in the day when there was a whole lot of misuse and abuse going on. Look at how he responded to the temple and what he said about the temple and what he described about the temple and his zeal about the temple as it being God's house of praise. Hallelujah. And all of a sudden, if you begin to understand yourself in the terminology that God used of us in the New Testament, calling us the temple of the Holy Ghost, and then you begin to understand that in reference to that the application of that terminology, where the holies of holies existed, you're going to think different. The tenets of Hinduism, Buddhism, and all the other isms that have tried to be integrated with Christianity, that tries to make you feel undone when he's made you done, you complete. You're not half-baked, you cooked, totally through and through. This is what the scripture says. Paul said, you are complete in him. You are finished. Hallelujah. The work of salvation, and the reality of it is, it's either born again or you're not born again. It's like you're either pregnant or you're not. You're not kind of. You're not kind of something. It's happened. It's an event that has taken place. And we're going to have to really grab a hold of this and begin to understand what's important to God. I mean, I was just contemplating Isaiah 26 last night and verse 18, where, and really all in the context of revival, you guys, God saying, you guys are acting like a woman that's in pain, about to, you're coming before me, crying out to me, saying you want to know me, want to be used by me, going to participate with my will. And now you're like a woman crying out in pain as though you're going to deliver a baby, and all it is you're passing gas. Don't look at me like that. That's what Isaiah 26, 18 says. All you're doing is passing wind, is what it says. It's true. And that's too much of what, because it was a bunch of words. It was boisterous words with no reality, with no heart, with no application. It was something that only existed for them when they stood in the temple. It didn't have any application. It was full religion and ritual. It had no real application when they woke up in the morning, when they tended the sheep and tended the oxen and did their business in the city or in the field. And the last thing that you and I want to do is to be like that. There's been a lot of bellowing about revival, a lot of bellowing about walking with God, but very few people willing to pay the price. And the price isn't some terrible yoke. The price is something that is a burden that is easy and that is light. It's the burden of the Lord Jesus. It's coming to just say, look, I want to know about heaven. I just got informed today that Charisma is going to publish my book on the rise of the seventh and the eighth kingdom. They're going to call it The Last Two Kingdoms of the Earth. But don't do that. Thank you, though. I appreciate that. Because I just want to stay right where I'm at, okay? I don't save for applause. The reality of it is, and my desire is people to recognize why it is so important that they come out of the world. Why that any integration with the world, any application of sin in your life, any application of the demonic and the rebellious demeanor in your life that belongs to the satanic realm is going to ultimately result in your deception and your total ruin. And people think, as they read the Bible about the last days, and they think it's about everybody else, concerning seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, and the Antichrist spirit that was already at work in the church 1970 years ago to date. You don't understand. Everybody says it's 2000, about 2000, 1970 years ago to this day, that the church, that Jesus went up, hallelujah, He offered himself at Calvary's cross for us. Praise God. Hallelujah. And hallelujah. Went up into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father, poured out the Holy Ghost. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We just want to help you. I understand. I know what pressures have been put upon you. All your work, all your workload, all the things that you've got to do. How much this world and the cares of this life are afflicting you and demanding of you great, enormous amounts of your time. You hardly have any time to sit down and relax. Understand? But somehow you're going to have to recognize that if you begin to give the first fruits of your life to the Lord, something's going to happen. And God's going to work a miracle, a multiplication, as it were, of time. God's going to work a multiplication, as it were, even of finances and favor and ability, to where that you're not so consumed with the thing. Because I'm telling you right now, if Satan can consume you, if he can trick you, if there's an open door, he will do it. And I'm going to tell you how he's able to do it. When we do not take heed unto the Word of God is our only defense against everything that Satan would do. Listen, I'm telling you right now, the truth is the only defense against a lie. The truth is the only means that we may be able to be protected against deception. Praise God for the Holy Ghost that has come to lead us and guide us into all truth. But what happens if we're not listening to him? What happens if we're just... it has nothing to do with the sincerity of your heart. Has nothing to do with the passion of your soul. Has nothing to do with how serious you are. It has rather to do with how obedient you are, whether or not you're going to listen to God and take instruction and do what he says to do. Because there's a lot of serious people who really meant to do well that are burning in hell right now. You listening to me? Buddhists, Hindus, Jews, Muslims, the world as a whole in general, Christians. I remember when I first heard, well, I've heard actually several different opportunities to hear of different people who died who were Christians, nominal Christians. They were members of the church. They paid tithe. And one particular who died of a disease went down in the hill, and God raised him back up again. And it was proof that God raised him back up again by the things that he did in his life. He's dead now. It was a great impact upon the church. A great impact. His life was an everyday living in heaven. I mean, you know that he had a major encounter with God. And but the reality of it is that's just so true. And Christ Jesus lays it out for us in his word. And he tells us very clearly that not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is coming into the kingdom. It's rather those people who are going to do the will of the Father. Those people who are going to cease from sin. He says, Jesus is going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I don't know you. You person who practice sin. We know that everyone who's born of God doesn't practice the sin. They've come out from among them. But how do you ultimately find yourself participating with that separation? Because the word for separation is inseparable from the word of consecration, which is inseparable from the word for holiness. It's inseparable. Those concepts are not even possible outside of you and I being born of God, being born again. And when we're born again, we're his, man. From the crown of the head to the soles of our feet, we become the holy dwelling place of Almighty God. He sets up the holies of holies in our life. Somebody said, how do you know? Because Father comes to dwell on the inside of us. John chapter 14 and verse 20, you know, verse 17, I love the pericope, verses 17 through verse 24, because it's so impactful, this message of the Lord Jesus Christ concerning the Holy Ghost will be with us and in us, concerning the reality in that day we shall know that he is in the Father and that Christ Jesus is in us. That impactful message of Jesus said, if you'll keep my commandments, I will come and manifest myself to you, and my Father and I will come and make our dwelling with you. There can't be anything more descriptive of the holies of holies than that. Do you hear me? What happens when you begin to think of yourself after the fashion in which God has described us to be? What happens if you quit believing those things about yourself according to as you have believed them, as other people have told you, as philosophies and ideologies have influenced you, and you just set all that apart and you become saturated with the Word? Somebody told me, I read the Bible once, I'm like, big deal. I've read it hundreds of times, I still don't really get it all. I'm still like just a baby here going, oh God, open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy word, kind of thing. Hello. You know, my wife is a great example to me because she's constantly in the word. She's, you know, I downloaded her another application on her iPhone, which is the real value of her iPhone, so she could listen to the Bible from, you know, somebody else who flows more differently. And just the words are always open. And you know, hey, praise God, that needs. And is she busy? She's very busy. She's not sitting in the corner idle. But you know what? There's a way to integrate the things of the Spirit in your life all day long. It's just that you've got to be willing to change. You've got to be willing to be different. You've got to be willing to accommodate God. I mean, that's a terrible way to say it. But I mean, that's a step up from ignoring him. Hello? Accommodating God is a definite step up from ignoring him. Hello? No, when I would intentionally ignore God, you just do it. It just happens that way. It just turns out that way all day long. You've gone all day long, and you've not even uttered a word towards heaven, and you're laying down to sleep, and you're so tired now you don't have the energy, even though you remembered. You know that many people live their life that way. I'm not saying that anybody here in this place lives their life that way. I pray that you do not. But I guarantee you, you can run the risk if you don't understand how to become that sacred vessel, that person described in the Word of God. Quit feeling so stinking bad about yourself, because you don't stink and you're not bad. You know what I'm saying? I mean, God has made you good. He said, you know, Peter said, that's unclean. Paul said, God said, don't call what I've made clean unclean. I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of people running around saying they've been born of the Spirit, washed in the blood of the Lamb, and calling themselves unclean, lower than a worm's belly, and all the rest of the other kinds of things they come up with from the Hinduism that is integrated, and the Neoplatonism that is integrated, and the doctrines of Aristotle, the doctrines of Socrates that are integrated into biblical theology. No, it's true. Because the Word of God describes something very different than 3rd and 4th century Christianity. It's very different. Spend a couple of years doing an evaluation of all the text. You'll be amazed. You'll start reading things by the supposed church fathers and go, wait a minute, I just read that with Socrates. You won't be going, oh yeah, I just remember reading that in the scripture. You just, well, I just remember reading that with Aristotle. Philo said that. Who was a student, who was a Hebrew student of Plato. Give me a break. But unfortunately, most of God's people have not even the ability to discern. They just think it's all good. They're just running around, and then it becomes a filter by which they begin to read the Bible. And then it loses its power, therefore they're not hungry. But no, I mean, goodness, when you begin to commune with God and the Holy Ghost, mamandate resheya. I mean, it's hard to turn the thing off. You know, we were listening to Alexander last night. Read the Bible. He reads the Bible great. And we were both worn out. We were both tired. And he was, but he was on Isaiah 5, and I couldn't wait for Isaiah 6. I had to just hear it before I went to sleep. She said, I'm falling asleep. Let me turn it off. Got a little iPhone out there. I said, just give it a few more minutes. I just wanted to see the glory just before I doze off. Suddenly, as you begin to live your life in the Holy Ghost, whoo, and you begin to live your life without condemnation, because they that are in Christ Jesus, there is no condemnation. Those who walk now after the Spirit and not after the human realm, not after the human ability, not after trying to please God, not after an Ishmaelite, but an Isaacite. You know, not after one who was a substitute to the covenant, but one who is in the covenant, a descendant of the covenant, born of God, born of the Spirit, born of the Word, made the holy dwelling place of Almighty God. What do I got to do tonight to get you convinced to be reconciled unto God? What must I do to convince you tonight to be the holy dwelling place of Almighty God, to be one that has been made His through and through, spirit, soul, and body, made holy so that God can preserve it blameless. My spirit, soul, and body right now, according to the Bible, is blameless. According to church and Christian theology, it's messed up. It's still got problems. There's a root of iniquity that's got to be dug out. Having begun in the spirit, are you now made perfect by human ability? God forbid. That's a heresy. Do you need to do something else? Paul said you've fallen from grace. You need to do something else after that you've been born again. You need to get circumcised. You need to work on this. You need to work on that. You need to better yourself. You've fallen from grace. God in His mercy and His love has extended to us the gift of righteousness. God in His mercy and love has extended to us the gift of holiness, having given us this new birth where we're made a new creation and everything old has passed away. It's about time you start talking to yourself concerning those words which God has spoke, for it's His truth that will keep you from deception. It'll keep you out of the hand of the enemy, out of even being able to be accessed by him. I mean, I love what John says. I fell in love with this verse of scripture the first time I read it. I found so many people offended by it, but I fell in love with it. The first time I read it, I'm like, wow, this is amazing. And then I just went around and started telling different people about it, and they're getting all red-faced and upset. What you talking about? What you trying to say? And I'm like, what is this kind of the manifestation that is going on in people's lives when I'm trying to tell them about something beautiful that God said about us? We know that everyone that is born of God does not sin, but he keeps himself and the wicked one cannot touch him. We're all upset. I didn't say it, man. It's right here. Look, read 1 John 5:18. I didn't say it. I didn't even say it. And then I get in there and throw in on the glory of the fact that we've got the divine nature and have escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. I'm just like rejoicing, free at last, praise God. I'm excited, you know what I'm saying? My goodness, what a verse of scripture, 2 Peter, you know, 1:4. What a verse of scripture. People all upset. What are you saying? You mean I can't have my time with the devil no more? Because really, that's what they mean. They don't want to be completely free. They don't want to understand he that the Son says free is free indeed. They don't want to understand the truth. You should know the truth and the truth shall make you free. They don't want to understand the glorious liberty of the sons of God, where we have been translated, delivered from the powers of darkness and translated into the kingdom of the dear Son. Man, you know, here's my problem. I started memorizing the Bible. You know, and the Lord led me. The first thing first book of the Bible that the Lord led me to memorize was the first epistle of John. Memorize it sometime. Somebody said, I can't memorize. Yeah, you will. You ask God to help you and he'll fix your brain for you. He'll fix it up right good. And the Holy Ghost will bring these things into your remembrance. On top of that, he'll work a miracle for you. Man, I'm like walking around, he that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. Hallelujah. I'm excited about that. To this very day, right now, I'm excited. It's what allows me to walk in a place where there is now, therefore, no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. I'm in Christ Jesus and he's in me. He did this wonderful thing. He stood up there in John chapter 15 is how we named this church. And he said, come on over here and dwell in me. He didn't say dwell with me. He said, come on over here and dwell in me. Come abide in me. Hallelujah. Woo! I mean, that's exciting. The problem is people allow the lies and the accusations of Satan to steal from them this wonderful union, this wonderful fellowship with all the guilt and all the shame and all the misinformation that has filled your head. And then you go sit down and watch TV and it makes it worse. And listen to the radio and it compounds it. Then you go hang out on the beach with your friends. Are you completely done? And now you got to come back on Sunday morning, come to the altar call, repent, reconsecrate, come back to Jesus. And people live with a defiled conscience so they never step into the beauty of the fellowship. Ooh, rabba basaya.
the mystery of the fellowship, Christ Jesus in me. Hallelujah. This is what we teach every man, that we may present every man complete in Jesus.
You're never going to be complete until you will accept what he has done for you. You're never going to have the miracle of the faith until you agree with them. If somebody does not know that they've been born again and then their name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're not right with God. You're not saved. God brings to us an understanding that we may know him. Hallelujah. He brings to us a revelation that we're with him and in him. When we've had an event of that new birth, we know that God the Father dwelt in Jesus Christ and that Jesus Christ dwells in us, and everything changes. That's the day that we're born in righteousness, to be shaped in purity. Instead of living in the legacy of being born in sin and shaped every day in iniquity, taught the ways of demonic powers. If there's anything I'm doing with this book that God has opened the doors miraculously for me in, is I want to convince people that there is two simultaneous realms of the spiritual going on right now, and that you're going to be holy in one or the other. You're not going to have 2 feet. You're not going to have 1 foot in both realms. It ain't going to happen. Huh? It ain't going to happen. It ain't going to happen. You're going to have to be persuaded that you're totally given over to God, and as a newborn baby, can desire the sincere milk of the word. You're going to have to be totally persuaded that you've been bought with a price, that you're not your own, that you belong to God, and now you can glorify him in your body and your spirit, which are his. You can come to a place and understand that your body is his purchased possession, that you're the redeemed of the Lord, that you washed in the blood, that your garments are spotless, yea, whiter than snow. He's loosed us from our sins in his own blood and made us priests and kings unto our God, and we shall reign with him forever. Come on, people. I mean, my goodness. I watch people just laboring to save up for a 401k. I doubt you'll spend it. Worried about your Social Security. I doubt you'll spend it. Why not consider the ant? I watch people be more concerned about where their grave plot is going to be and take out an insurance policy and make sure it's paid for than to take concern of where they're going to be the moment they breathe out the last breath that goes out of their nostrils. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to go into, I'm telling you right now, you listen to me. At that moment, every prayer meeting you've ever missed is going to flash before you. Every Bible study you've ever missed is going to flash before you. Every day you live to do your own thing is going to flash before you. All the things that God has said and has spoken and commanded you to do that you didn't do is going to right there, right before you, is going to flash before you. People, I'm telling you about, this is wisdom. I'm giving you insight. I'm telling you about the way it's going to be. Somebody tells me, asks me, says, what is it going to be like when I die? I'm telling you right now. I'm going to tell you, they that believe on the Lord Jesus Christ will not see death. That's what Jesus said in John chapter 10. Also said something similar in John 5 and also in John 8. But literally passing, we pass from death into life because we have this love of the brethren, a measurable love. It's the same love that Jesus loved us with, and the same love that the Father loves Jesus with. It's no other kind of love. It's not, I love Walmart's prices or Arco Gas or whatever. Or I love my puppy dog. This is the love that lays down your life. And if God's people knew this love, there would be no problem with covenant keeping. There would be no one going to another church, being all upset with other people, having some kind of hurt and accusation. They just don't know the love. And worse than that is many of these people have done these kinds of things. They've broken covenant and they've self-justified and they've never repented for their hatred. They've never repented for their wrong, their evil. Because as soon as you cease to do the love of the Father, hey, listen, we're going to trip up. There's no question about it. As we grow up, we're going to trip up. And we're going to have temper tantrums. And we're going to be fussy. And we're going to probably get into some serious arguments with one another. But having walked in the Holy Ghost and having lived your life in the Spirit, you're going to be quick to come and say, forgive me. I'm sorry. Please, I did wrong. I don't ever want to do that again. I love you. And I thank God that he's filling me up with his love in such a way. And he's poured his love inside of me in such a way that I can love you just like he's loved me. Because with what love I love is the kind of love I'm going to get. With what mercy I meet, it's the kind of mercy I'm going to get. With what forgiveness I give, it's the kind of forgiveness I'm going to get. Hello. Amen.
Hello? Hello? Must I be this little sergeant screaming at Gomer? What are you doing? Gomer, what's wrong with you? Because it seems to me that that's really almost the thing, the only thing that opens up people's ears is start screaming, hollering at them, and slapping them around. But that ain't gonna do any good. What does it take? What does it take for you to begin to allow the Holy Ghost to move in your life to where a brokenness is created? I tell you what it takes. Spending time with Jesus. When all of a sudden you begin to spend time with Jesus, the more you spend time with Jesus, you know when people spend time with Jesus because of the way they talk about him. You know that people spend time with Jesus because of how important he is. I'm moving out of the praise the Lord phase into the praise the name of Jesus. I'm taking it up another level. If you start plastering the name of Jesus is the name that is above every name. And when you're one with him and when you're captivated by what he's done for you, because he's done more for you than he did for the blind man. He's done more for you than he did for the woman with the issue of blood. He's done more for you than he did for the crippled, the lame that ran leaping and praising than went, shouting over their deliverance. He's done more for you than the ones that was raised from the dead physically. He has given to you a life that cannot be taken away, a peace that passes all understanding, a joy that is unspeakable. He's given you a place in him, a name in him that will never pass away, a place where you're seated together with him in a heavenly realm. How can we be preoccupied with other things? I just want to stir you up. I want to stir you up. I want to get you out of whatever it is you into. You don't need no stinking career. Because it stinks, and it's a distraction. You don't need that. What you need to do is be willing to follow the Lord Jesus Christ and let him take you into the great plans that God has for you, because he doesn't have many laborers. Every time I talk to anybody that's doing anything in the kingdom of God, their biggest number one issue is not money, it's not infrastructure, is there's no laborers, man. Where are the human resources? We can't get anything done. I know that that's what's going on with Father. He doesn't have human resources. He's got a gigantic nursery. Are you listening to me? Go ahead and laugh at yourself for a minute. Go ahead and laugh at yourself. Go ahead and laugh at yourself. Got a gigantic nursery. Thank you. Everybody's just sitting around, fussing and complaining and whining and wanting to get their cracker and their juice. And all upset because nobody's cleaned their diaper and it's been wet for now 2 minutes or whatever. You know what I'm saying? No, it's just that way. It's time for us to step up into the program. Actually, Paul described the new birth in a radical, miraculous growth. In the sense that even as a newborn babe in Christ, once you're born again, Paul described in Galatians chapter 4 that we're immediately matured sons. No. He did it. Go read it. Start John 4, 1. Forgive me. Galatians chapter 4, verse 1, and hit verse 7. And you're going to be blown away. Because he says, when you are, he starts talking about the people under the first covenant. He said they were just children. They were children under the first covenant. Held before coming into the realms of the promise, into the new covenant, into the new birth. He said, you're like children. And though you be Lord of all, you differ nothing from your servants that are around you, but are set under tutors and set under mentors until the day appointed. But then he comes out with this boisterous thing about how that now through what we've received, this wonderful sonship that we've been given, we've now stepped into sons. And he describes it on the level of those who have now stepped into the inheritance that are no longer children that differ nothing from a servant, but now are those who are fully vested to go ahead with the program. Excuse me while you yawn. That go ahead with the program. I know everybody's tired and you're worn out and you're weary. I recognize that. I'm amazed that you can even hold your eyes up to listen to me, seeing as how the world and the earthly interest has taxed you to no end. And now on top of that, Christmas has come. And you got extra duties. Come on, people. We're going to have to move beyond this stuff. Come on now. Come on now. You're going to have to get out the rat race. You're going to have to get off the sad go-around. Not the merry-go-round. The sad go-around. You're going to have to quit grinding meal for the Philistines with your eyes plucked out and your hair cut off, going round and round every day, round and round and round. And all you see is the same terrible circumstances. It's time now for you to begin to mount up with wings as an eagle. Now it's time for you to begin to learn how to begin to flow in the Holy Ghost, how to begin to participate with taking a drink that Jesus described, so that out of your innermost being, out of the depths of your passions and emotion, explodes the glory of Almighty God in such an inexhaustible and unlimited way that all Jesus could do was like it unto rivers. That's scary. You listen to me. That's scary. Why? Because you get around where rivers are converging and you got those kind of waterfalls going off, because that's what you're going to have. And you got those kind of currents. Man, that is a scary sight. Don't you jump in. You're going to go straight. The currents are going to take you right down to the bottom. But you can sink to the bottom and breathe, man, in this. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, I've watched the currents and the surf. You know, I'm going to be 57 here in a couple months. I've watched the currents and the surf since I was a little guy, since I was 10 years old. You know, we're standing on the Zambezi not too long ago and, you know, thinking about jumping in. And I'm looking at all those boils. I'm looking at all of those various different currents that are actually, you know, spitting up almost like a wave about 3 to 4 foot tall. And I can visualize it. I can see what happens. Those go all the way down to the very bottom of that deep river, and then they come back up. That's what makes those eddies. That's what makes those seeming waves. Huh? Man, we got such a glory supposed to be busting out of us. Everybody should be swept away, man. Every sickness should be healed. But we don't want to give our time. The problem is we don't want to invest our time into what it takes to learn how to cooperate with the things of the Holy Ghost. God's given it, and it's a free gift, but we don't recognize we're going to have to make a decision to live in that realm. I got this free gift. Thank you, Father. Bless you. He's so wonderful. And we're back over here doing our stuff. I listen, and I'm going to tell you right now, I'll be a witness against you. Those that are here that don't listen to me and those you're watching by web, I worked a secular job, preached every single day of the week. Listen to me. I worked a secular job. I got up very early in the morning. In fact, before that, I was in school. I had classes like physical chemistry, physiology. Okay, physical chemistry is enough. Physiology and organic chemistry, and was preaching and having meetings every night. You listen to me. That transitioned over into full-time job, working church every single night. Don't tell me you don't have time. Give me a break. You need to step up. Yes. You need to wipe sissy off your face and step up. Yes. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. You need to wipe powder puff off your face and toughen up. I mean, come on. I mean, the reality of it is the Lord gives grace. He gives us a divine energy, and he gives us a divine ability. And there's only gain, and there's only increase. If you step out and you begin to obey God, and you begin to consecrate your life to him, he's going to multiply who you are, and he's going to multiply what you have, and he's going to bless your time, and he's going to bless you everywhere you go, and there's going to be favor on your head. Come on. Hallelujah. Everything you do is going to be blessed. And sometimes it might take you a little while to find that out. But God said it, and that's good enough. And yeah, there's things that seemingly have to be worked out. It seems like there's postponements, but it's not a postponement. It seems like there's a delay. There's not a delay. No, God's just shaping and working things out. He's producing something on the inside of you that could never be produced without it. Come on, people. To begin to believe what God says above what you think. To begin to do what God has asked you to do rather than what you're preoccupied to do. Because reality of it is man is demanding of you how you're supposed to live your life, and you're obeying men and not God. You listen to me. Oh, no one wants to put it in those words. Don't tell me that, please. But this is just absolutely true. And then you get all saucer-eyed about your new job and your raise, and you go out there and put your life on the line with a mortgage, and then you go after and you buy yourself a new shiny car, and now you are twice the slave, three times the slave. And oh, now you got to be in your commitments to man because, oh, you got to honor man. How about keeping your commitments to God and honoring God? Amen. Did you read the contract? Did you read the contract? Hello? Yeah. Some of you haven't read it. Yeah. I'm going to tell you right now. I can tell by the way you're preoccupied. You haven't read the contract. I just got this contract today from Charisma. I read it, but I'm going to have Ann read it too so she can give me some advice. Because that's good to get an opinion from somebody else, and that's what I'm giving you right now, opinion on the contract. I read the contract too. I'm afraid you missed more than whole paragraphs. I'm afraid you overlooked entire books. You listening to me? Hallelujah. Or if you didn't overlook them, you don't know how to apply them. You're just stuck. I'm overwhelmed. Pastor, what do I do? I sold my soul for a house and a car and a plot of land. And I'm unhappy and I'm miserable and I'm trying to mitigate it with Sunday morning. But I ain't making much progress.
Now, people don't want me talking like that.
Why don't I just go ahead and make it what it is? And even if I were to make it bigger than what it is, it's still a very valuable thing to you that you might run to the place of shelter and safety and make sure that you're doing it according as God has demanded. Because he's not compromising, changing in any way his word. He's not going to say, when people say, well, I'm something special to the Lord, he's going to modify everything he said on my account. Because we got this special agreement. No, he's going to treat you just like everybody else that disobeys. His word is not compromisable. His word is the only thing that is going to cause you and I to step into the inheritance that he has for us. The sonship that he's given, it's all free, but it's going to have to somehow become valuable to us. What the blood of Jesus Christ has done is going to have to somehow become meaningful to us.
You know, one of the things that I've emphasized in the book is how that everything that happened in the past with the kingdoms of the past and the rulers in these various different kingdoms that represent the kingdom that's the last two kingdoms that are yet to come under Antichrist. At the very center of what the angels and the demon spirits were doing, were bringing men into a place of teaching them how to be so given over to sexual immorality and so given over to all kinds of evil imaginations. And now we look at the advent of the World Wide Web, and it's taken it to a whole nother level, in so much so that now we can hear the prophecy of Peter as he gave it in 2 Peter chapter 3, saying, men having eyes full of adultery who cannot cease from sin. We live in that day. We live in the day of itching ear doctrines. We live in the way of I demand it the way that I think it. We live in the day of don't tell me what to do. I know just as good as you. Who do you think you are insulting me? I'll have no one rule over me. Marad is the Hebrew word. Marad, and it's from that word that we derive the name Nimrod, the rebel one, the rebel, the one who rebelled against God. And here we are in the church. I want you to pray with me. I want you to believe God with me that he will begin to send me to the churches. I believe the Lord's opening up all kinds of doors. I see it happening. Even today when I receive this contract, I know God's going to open up so many doors because I know what their machine wants me to do, and I'm happy to do it. Their machine wants me to go to all the churches. They line up, and I'm happy to go. And all the other things that God is opening. And I want you to pray not only for me that the Lord will open up effectual doors for me so that I can begin to try to see so many lost and dying people sitting in the pews of the church come to know the Redeemer who've been intercepted with religion. I want you to begin to do the same thing. I want you to just step on over. Somebody said, what's wrong with me? I got a problem. Okay, well, fine. We'll just quit whining and step on over here. Step on over here. Don't sit down and start, oh, I got hurt. The bat hit me in the arm. Well, big deal, man. Brush it off and get up. You know what I'm saying? Come on, you know how you were treated on the playground. You know what you said to people around you. So quit acting like that problem person. Are you listening to me in the things of the Spirit? The Lord has made us soldiers of the kingdom and taught us how to endure hardness, not softness. We the people are supposed to be walking around bearing the death of the Lord Jesus Christ in our body. that the life of Jesus Christ might also be revealed in our body. We're supposed to be the people that have been given over to death by the Lord on account of the Lord Jesus Christ, that his life might also be made manifest in our mortal flesh. You know, I've said that before, and people thought I was just coming up with some crazy ideas. Where'd he get that from? Well, I tell you where I got that crazy idea from. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 8 through 9. Hello. Jesus, help us. The Word of God's so foreign to us. And it shouldn't be. It should be that which we live and eat and think and meditate upon. It is near unto us in our heart and in our mouth that we may be able to do everything that God has said for us to do. Hallelujah. He's written his word upon the statutes and his judgment upon our heart and upon our minds so that we can do them. Hallelujah. Talk about the word living on the inside of us. Hallelujah. The living word himself come to dwell in me. I mean, the psalmist said, thy word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against you. How about when the living word comes on the inside of you? Now what you got going on for you? Hello. And the only problem that people have with all the addictions and all the backslidings and perpetual backsliding, constantly falling into iniquity, is because they don't spend time with the Lord. They're literally caught up in a world system that is run by angels of darkness and demon spirits. And that's why Paul said, look, I know how to do this thing. Listen to me. I'm telling you right now, you can be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. You can take unto yourself the whole armor of God. God's made it available so you can stand against all the spiritual wickedness and all the principalities and powers of darkness that are now trying to mandate their will from their high places. But we're in a higher place if we're willing. We're in such a higher place today under our feet. Hallelujah. We're in a higher place because God has exalted the name of Jesus above all principalities and powers and might and dominion, every name that is named. People, I want to hear you start getting the name of Jesus on your lips. I don't hear enough people say Jesus, talk about Jesus, speak Jesus, pray Jesus. Come on, man. Where is the name of Jesus? The name of Jesus needs to be always upon your lips. It needs to be plastered over your life. I mean, it needs to be tattooed across your forehead. You listening to me? You guys need to practice this one word that you're having problems with in your vocabulary. I'm certain of it. I'm certain that the whole church is having problems. I mean, one of the things we might just even think about doing here, probably be a good thing. I mean, once you get comfortable telling everybody Merry Christmas, because I feel it. I can see people having a problem. I mean, you need to get out in people's face and with a joy in the Holy Ghost say, Merry Christmas. Oh, you can't do that. Who says you can't do that? A demonic realm, an antichrist realm. What, you already taking the mark? You already bowing before his image and worshiping him? Coming under his influence and his oppressive spirit? Because I'm telling you right now, if you can't say Merry Christmas, you'll first in line to be tattooed. Are you listening to me? Then you move on up to say, Happy Jesus Day. Praise God. I'm so happy that they got a day to worship Jesus still in America with all the rest of the stuff that's going on. You go ahead and preach a whole long sermon right there before they even get to say no, or you can't say that around here. Put it up at work. Hallelujah. Put it on a flag and let it fly from your antenna like everybody does with their favorite God ball team. The idol that they shout to and they lift up their voice and they give their emotions to. There's a problem with that. You read about it. There's a problem with that. Huh? Yeah. I was with a bunch of preachers the other day. My goodness. They got the flags out. I tell you right now, they put helmets on, shoulder pads, jerseys. I mean, my goodness, they had the whole football team in the living room screaming, ah! I'm like, this is inordinate. I sit there on the couch going, Father, am I the only one that gets this? Am I the only one that can feel this thing? Is there something wrong with me? I start asking, Lord, please heal me. Heal me. There's something wrong with me. There's something that must be wrong with me. I messed up in the head. I got wrong perceptions. I got wrong sense and feeling about this. I don't even think if you could match that in church, I still don't think it would be right. How are you listening to me? To give your whole self over to that way? That's like with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. It really is. God says, you have no other gods alongside of me. Amen. Huh? Alongside of me. He said, I'm not sharing your trophy shelf. I'm not sharing your passions. I'm not sharing your interests. And friendship with the world. Somebody said, God, I tell you right now, God, for the Cleveland, whatever. I tell you right now, God is voting right now. I'm rooting right now for the Packers. No, he's not. There's got to be baseball in heaven. Praise God. No, there's not. You have a wrong conception of the realms of glory. You're not going to even want that. It has no place in the realms of the Spirit. Next time you get caught up in the realms of the glory, see how overwhelmed you are about, you know, the Cleveland Dodgers or whatever they're called. Huh? Or the Green Bay Raiders or whatever they're called. You know, I just said that. You know, I know that. But I want to be that disinterested. Help us, Jesus. And it doesn't stop there. Unfortunately, it doesn't stop there. Our trust and our emotions and our passions and our needs are so wrapped up in so many various different things within the financial realm, within the material realm, with all these things that we think that we've got to have and we can't live without. And when we don't got them, we're accusing everybody around us and God as well. People, let's just clean escape. Let's just come over here and just start worshiping the Lord till we know him. And understand, you know, the Word of God, the beautiful thing about the Word of God is it gives you the ability to discern between evil and good. Without it, you'll never learn. And it's by continual use. The Scripture says by continual use. Hallelujah. I have discovered that the more I walk in obedience to the Lord, the more I get to see and understand. God retains all rights to revelation. He's the one who opens up our eyes. When we're walking in obedience, something happens, dear people. As we continue to walk in obedience, the Spirit of wisdom and revelation continues to provide for us insight, and he opens up our eyes to behold wondrous things out of his word. I want to shake you free from the demonic. I want to shake you free from the interest of the world. I want to shake you free from earthly things. It's not Hinduism either. I'm not talking about no desire. Huh? I'm talking about one big gigantic desire. One big gigantic. Did you hear me? One big gigantic desire in Christ Jesus. Somebody said, how do you spell that? G-O-D. Gigantic. You got it. Hallelujah. Batase beriteki manabase peya. Imbrando sotikina masando lo paora ya pa sotina masi hala masi perenia pataya habrebe manda saya. When you start praying in the Holy Ghost, I can tell whether you prayed in the Holy Ghost today or not. I can tell, because I can tell how well the river's flowing. Don't go into the church with, you know, the prime. You know what I'm saying? You need to come to the meeting flowing in the Holy Ghost. You need to make the things of heaven of the most important and the most valuable interest in your life. Don't prioritize God anymore, dear people. Stop it. Stop telling me about all these other interests and stop telling me about all these other things you got to do. And just spend some time learning how wonderful it is to hang out with the Lord. I'm not talking to you about some kind of laborious works where you're just basically slaving away for God and live, spending your ruining your life. I'm talking about you getting caught up in heaven. I'm talking about you being blessed with abundant life. Enjoying the unsearchable riches of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Begin to cry out to God like never before. To raise up laborers for the harvest. and let you and let God show you how that He's purposed to make you an answer to your own prayer. Begin to get bold with God and recognize that He laid hold on you so that you could lay hold on Him. Just as He jumped out and grabbed Jacob and laid hold on Jacob. Jacob turned that thing around. With a reverse Nelson, is that what they call him? God said, let me go, and it's direct disobedience. No, I will not let you go. Most modern preachers would say that's heresy. They would talk about how wrong that is, and if I'd be preaching that, they're probably on the way to hell, and anybody who listens to them is short to follow. You know what I'm saying? They do err, not knowing the word of God. They do err, not knowing the power of God. They do err, not having a relationship and a fellowship with Him to recognize the things that He's made available to us and the passion that He has a right to demand that we have when we come to receive. The prayer of the man of importunity, the bold, shameless prayer of the man who will not stop knocking, saying, I told you, get out of bed and rise and give me that which I have need of. And the Lord Jesus in His kind of way, I want you to pray right here. And we just can't get it. Why? Because we can't get past the shame, can't get past the guilt, can't get past the unqualified, can't get past all the issues that we've allowed the demonic realm to place upon us. And the demonic realm is the accuser, and the demonic realm is the slanderer, and the demonic realm is the separator. Thus, we live our lives far beneath what God has called us to dwell in. I want this night to be a place of transition for you. I want you to begin to understand what it means to touch heaven and flow in the Holy Ghost. And then be so in love with it and so captivated by this realm that you don't ever want to get out and discover that you don't ever have to, that you can live your whole day even in the midst of all the complication and all the tasks and all the things you've got to get done. You can do it. You can do it with joy and gladness in your heart. You can do it with strength and ability. You know, God's people still, I mean, come on. Now, there were those who had to, like Elisha, had to leave the plow and the oxen, but there were still that God blessed, and they were in the field. Hallelujah. And they remained the people of God. And they came, bless the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, who lift your hands in the house of the Lord every night, a place of gathering unto God and worshiping Him. You make your house a place of praise and sanctuary. You make your house, your first of all, your life. Quit demanding everybody else to do it. You do it. Hallelujah. Then you make your house because you are doing it. Not because you got everybody else making everybody else do it, because you're doing it. Hallelujah. Your house becomes a sanctuary and a place of worship. And you watch how God will bring it all around. Amen. Amen. You watch how all of a sudden the temptations and the things that tripped you up, they really are a very small, weak voice in the background because you're too captivated with the anointing. You know, if I didn't know anything about the anointing, and if I didn't know anything about the presence of the Lord and the beauty of the abundant life, I would be as messed up as everybody else who doesn't know how to walk with God and constantly living in sin. But it's the anointing, it's the glory of heaven, it's the beauty of His presence that says, Lord, I know the wages of sin is death. I got enough wisdom to recognize the wages of sin is death. It's going to lead me, it's going to draw me into a place of a demonic power over me. And I know, Lord, you're there to rescue me and you're there to deliver me. I want nothing interrupted in this fellowship. I don't want to sit here just trying to spend my whole life getting over one temptation, trying to get one over one power of darkness that has continually been able to slap me down, and then I die. And the mercies of God make heaven by on a banana peel. Saved us by fire kind of thing. I want to at every place meet the powers of darkness and the temptations and the trials coming at us and know how to walk in the authority and the strength and the power of the Lord, to where that as a young man, the word of God abides in me and I've defeated Satan. at every point. I write unto young men because you're strong. The word of God dwells in you. And then the beauty of stepping on over into the realms of, I write unto your fathers because you know him who is from the beginning. Come on, man. I mean, that's a call to me. Isn't that a call to you? Growing and maturing in the things of God. Hallelujah. Living the days of heaven on this earth right now. They could live days of heaven on the earth during the Old Testament, as it was described in Deuteronomy chapter 11. How much more now can we live days of heaven being seated in these heavenly places, caught up in the realms of the Spirit? Come on, people. Manderes de apokoya. Start giving yourself over to letting the Holy Ghost take the lead of your life. You're supposed to live in the Holy Ghost. You're supposed to live in the Holy Ghost. You're supposed to walk in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You know, the privilege that we have is we get to literally put on the Lord Jesus Christ. We get to put him on. You know, the powers of darkness would come into our life much as what we would see even in the Old Testament during the days of Abraham and the early formative years of Israel as a nation. During the days of Abraham sojourning in the land of Canaan, he didn't really have to come up against the powers of darkness in the sense of the way that the giants fortified the land. They were around him, but they weren't there in that place that he occupied. And he goes and buys, for example, he buys a grave for Sarah, his wife, in Hebron. And by the time now that Israel is released from their captivity of being in captivity in Egypt for about 240 years of thereabout, they come into a place now where the powers of darkness have moved in to make sure to stop God's people from being able to enjoy their inheritance. Doing everything that they possibly can do to defy God. That's the demon spirits. That's what angels do. Angels of darkness do. That's what demon spirits do. That's what the satanic realm does. And it's more personified in the Old Testament. And New Testament is more perfectly spiritualized for what it really is. But nonetheless, you know, even there in Hebron, it was a land that God gave to Abraham as a possession. And on top of that, he purchased it as a grave site and a possession to bury his loved ones and his relatives. And four great giants, four of the mighty giants that lived in the land, had occupied it and fortified it so that it could not be a part of God's people's inheritance. Praise God for somebody who had the word of God in them, who was ferocious about the inheritance of God and the purposes of God, and said, give me that mountain. I'll take it from those giants. I'll take it from those that would defy the armies of God. I'll take it from those demon spirits, from those powers of darkness that would try to say I can't have it. I'm as strong today as I was when Moses told me a long time ago I could have it. Hallelujah. When I went and spied out the land, and all you rebels wouldn't come in. Of course, there weren't any rebels at that time. They were all dead. When your rebel parents would come in, whose carcasses had to die in the wilderness. Are you listening to me? I'm talking about you. I'm talking about the stuff that's stopping you. Huh? Because those demon spirits are still around. They didn't go away. They're still, once again, doing everything they can do to keep God's people from living in the inheritance that God bought, purchased, and sealed through the blood of Jesus Christ, as much as he bought, purchased, and sealed it for Abraham and their Israel back in that day, 3,500 years ago. There's very few Calebs. There's very few Joshuas. Why don't you go ahead and be one? I'm going to tell you right now, you get to be fulfillment of Joshua, because Jesus' name is actually Joshua. Is a direct translation from the Hebrew language, Yehoshua, not Yeshua, Yehoshua, which shows the thematic name of Yehovah in it, and not what the Aramaic language made it, and what the insults of those rabbinic writings made it. Hallelujah. He's living on the inside of me, and the glory and the beauty and the splendor of that. Come on. You'll have to rise up now. See, the reality of it is if you'll just begin to engage in a deeper way in the things of the Spirit, your eyes will be open. You'll be able to see what's going on. You won't be so easily taken out. You won't be tripped up. Satan kind of just hangs around, just waiting, lurking. Say, now, well, she's strong right now. He's strong right now. But give him a couple of days. Give him a couple of weeks. He's got a cycle. I've been keeping a notebook. That slip into the depression about week 3. Start complaining about middle of the week. By the end of the week, undo whatever I want to do with them. Hello. Yep. You know, you think I'm pretending. You think I'm just up here, you know, trying to put on a show and fill in the space of time. I'm helping you understand how the enemy's taking you. I'm trying to help you understand how to walk with God. I'm helping you understand that you can't compromise the Word of God. If you want to walk in sonship, you're going to have to walk in the Holy Ghost. As many as are led by the Holy Ghost, they are the sons of God. And be certain of this. When you're not being led of the Holy Ghost, when you're not under His authority, living in Him, walking in Him, you're not. You have to learn how to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for the help that's here tonight. We got the best help that's ever been provided. God, the Holy Ghost. We got the best in nature. Somebody said, well, I was just created weak. My dad was weak. All of us are just accommodators and facilitators and pushovers. All of us were cowards from all the way back to Adam, as far as we know. It doesn't matter. All of your relatives, all the way back to Adam, could have been cowards. But Christ Jesus changed you and come on the inside of you. And He's made, hallelujah. And He's given you everything that He is. Now you begin to walk in Him, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bon de repaya. Mea shiponanai. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the living God. You can think about whatever you want to think about yourself. Be high on yourself or be depressed about yourself. My advice to you is don't be anything about yourself. Get on over to Jesus. It's far better. Then you won't even care about what anybody says about your ancestry. Amen. Hallelujah. Mine go directly into heaven. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Rasataya Munjaya. Praise the name of Jesus. Purchase of blood, born of the Spirit, a new race, one with God, seated in the heavenly realm. God Almighty is our Father. Jesus Christ, our elder brother, Holy Ghost, our companion, joined and united unto our own spirit. That's a new race. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Blessed is the name. I can say Emmanuel because Christ is in me. God dwells in me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I can say complete in Him because I've been born again. Hallelujah. Whew. Hallelujah. I've received all that pertains in the life of godliness, all that pertains in the life of godliness, all that I have need of because His divine power is seen to it. Amen. And through that, He's called me to glory and virtue. Parisatania putoya. Hallelujah. Get out of the condemnation. Get out of the shame. Get out of the fear. Get out of an earthly vision of your life. You listen to me. Kids learn far more from what you do than what you say. And I'm not going to stand around and let people model something around. Wrong. If you in this house, you in God's house, my house, and you're going to learn how to do it right. Amen. If you don't like that, you got yourself a problem. You hear me?
Yes.
You'll learn how to do it right, especially if you're going to be an example to other people. You hear me?
Yes.
I mean, if you're not, if you're just sitting around, you know, and everybody knows that you, you know, whatever, then it's, I'm going to leave you alone. But if you're involved in supposedly being a witness of the Lord Jesus Christ and a model and an example of how we're supposed to behave ourselves in the house of God and how we're supposed to follow Him, live our life, and you an example to others, I'll make sure that you don't destroy yourself and them as well. Huh?
Yes.
No, the Lord said it'd be better if you're not eating their inner life that caused one of these to stumble.
True.
And you better understand what that means. I'm gonna be a watchman in the house of the Lord. You're just gonna have to understand that. I'm not looking to build a big house. I'm looking to participate with Father in building the right house, His house.
Amen.
The way He fashioned it, the way He laid it out. Praise yes. God. Hallelujah. Praise the name yes. of Jesus. Whew. Whew. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Praise Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. His name's like honey on my lips. His name is authority through my life that when I speak it, devils have to flee. Power and the authority of His name that is above every name, that at the preaching of it, the declaration of it, men's hearts are struck to the core and convicted of their sin, whether they act like it or not. To mention the name of Jesus, the Holy Ghost hovers over the lives of those that we encounter as the Spirit of the Lord has been poured out upon all flesh, brooding over them to bring forth life, to cause their darkness to go away and their chaos to cease, to bring forth a new creation. Hallelujah. I pray tonight in the name of Jesus that you'll consecrate yourself to His name, to His person, to His life. You consecrate yourself to the beautiful and sacred and wonderful Holy Ghost that has been given to us. You'll recognize that your life is sacred to God and it's got to become sacred to you. That your time is sacred to God and it's got to become sacred to you. That the people around you are sacred and you're going to demand of them the sacred. You're not going to let them get away with the profane. I guarantee you, dear people, deal with the cherubim about unsacred things. Deal with Jesus about unsacred things. Huh? Deal with the temple guards over unsacred things. Just go read about them. Just go read about them. Deal with a Levite over unsacred things, unconsecrated things coming around the house of the Lord. Don't let yourself get involved in the spirit of rebellion that so permeates the world. Because people, Christians, act like that somehow they cannot take heed unto the Word of God and then remain unaffected by this demonic stronghold that now works, this antichrist spirit that now works, this power of rebellion that produces the apostasy or the great falling away, which day we are in right now. People, you better understand, you're not immune. If you walk in the Holy Ghost, you'll be kept by the power of God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you just simply say yes to the Lord, you'll be kept by the power of God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. You'll be kept by the power of God. Hallelujah. Everybody stand with me. Dear people, I love you. We love you very much, but you're going to have to understand the Lord called me to be a pastor and a watchman in His house. He didn't call me to be a psychologist and a philosopher in His house. He called me to be a pastor and a watchman. And He gave me perfectly the assignment of what I'm supposed to do. He told me that I was to perfect the saints by the anointing and the mantle that He put upon my life. He told me that I was to build them up in the way, not build you up in you, but build you up in Him. Hallelujah. Building after the model and fashion which God the Holy Ghost builds, because unless the Lord builds a house, they that build it labor but in vain. Just want you to understand, God's commissioned me to reprove, to rebuke with long suffering. And in other words, don't give up, don't stop, keep it up. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I pray you can get excited about that, me not all depressed about that, disappointed about that. I pray that you'll get a heart towards God that says, oh Lord, I want to be instructed by, guided by, corrected by, go up upon my high place, see what the Lord says when He reproves me. Amen. Hallelujah. Just get yourself in your prayer life saying, Lord, shine the floodlight of heaven upon my soul. correct the things that are wrong. Lord, see if there's any wicked way that I'm allowing to influence me and lead me in the way everlasting. And then every word of correction is going to be a blessing to you. It's going to be like you just found riches. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And we're not going to do it just because we like beating on people, harassing people. We're just doing those things that the Lord has given us to do so that we can fully cooperate with Him and His glory can be revealed in our midst and we can be who He created us to be. We quit walking around, you know, all sad and sorrowful and upset and undone, unhappy. Hey, why don't you come over to the church, man? I'm telling you, the joy of the Lord's in the place. It's beautiful. It's singing, it's worshiping. They walk in, and people are like, what does that do? How does that impact Papa? Because he drew them. How does it impact him? Is he left greed? Said, I had no witness in the earth. I had no one that would show forth the joy of my salvation. They said that they were saved. They said that they had that which I produced. Huh? Come on now. We've got a responsibility. We've got to recognize that we have an enemy of our soul. You're born again. You're saved. Your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You've been reconciled to God, but you've got an enemy of your soul trying to keep you from living in your inheritance, trying to strip you of all the glory that Father has placed upon your life, trying to make it as though that you're not the redeemed of the Lord that has returned unto Zion and come with singing and everlasting joys upon your head. You got to recognize you're up against it. It's a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. You got to recognize that you're at war and that there is a place that you can come in and walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. Like I said at the beginning, where his yoke is easy and his burden is light, and you have all authority over all the powers of darkness to tread upon scorpions and serpents, over every dimension and manifestation of the powers of darkness, and nothing shall by any means hurt you, and it won't even be able to touch you. And if sickness tries to come on your body, you just shout a little bit louder. And if somebody gives you a bad report, you're just that much more happy about the promises and blessings of God. You know who He is. You know He's faithful, who's promised, who will also do it. Hallelujah. God is not a liar. Hallelujah. I pray in Jesus' name that as you get ready to go be with your relatives for Christmas, that you really know how to keep Christmas. That it becomes a Jesus fest. Because that would be a direct translation of the Latin, a Jesus fest. Are you listening to me? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You walk around saying, unto us, this day was born in the city of David. Christ the Lord. You know, you guys help me. I mean, I've been wanting the church to do an anointed Christmas program for many years. And we're going to get in it and we're going to get it done. Where the glory of heaven falls. Where it's not just a little show where everybody's like giggling over the kids, which is cute. I mean, it's tough. How can you not giggle when somebody like Josiah walks out, looks like John the Baptist with a big old huge wig? Huh? When somebody made the wings too big and you try to open them up and they're just all over the place. I mean, it's just comical. But there's a place to take it. There's a way to direct it. Because I'm telling you, the Christmas program that was done, I'm not speaking in any way negative about that. Wow. The props and the things that were done were good. It was great. It was great. It just said, I know there's a place, there's a realm of the anointing. There's a place of glory. There's a place of majesty that we can come and live and behold Him. I'm so earnest to take God's people there. I'm so earnest to take God's people there. And I'm just believing and pressing in for an increase of God in my life. where I can more fully take people to this place that Father's allowed us to come into. Hallelujah. I know that the more I spend time there, the more you spend time there, the more you can bring people into that realm. I don't want anybody walking out of here tonight with a desire for sin and iniquity in your life. The Lord said He's going to destroy those who have pleasure in unrighteousness. I want you to mark this. If there's any place of unrighteousness that you have pleasure in, I want you to understand it is an enemy of your soul, and I want to help you understand how to take the weapons of your warfare in your hands and kill it. I mean, kill it dead. As much as Caleb killed the four giants. As much as Moses took out Og. Are you listening to me? If I can just get you, I just want you to see it, because reality of it is the Lord uses phrases like that for us to understand the dividing line, for us to see just how wicked sin is. When He says the wages of sin is death, and He describes His wrath that falls upon those who have pleasure in unrighteousness, and all the list that goes on with that, so that we can begin to understand how terrible those realms are, and how we can stand as a defense against those things that Satan would try to deceive us with, because he's good at his craft. He's good. He led away the mighty angels that beheld the face of God throughout the eternity past in rebellion against God. If He's that good of a deceiver, what can He do to you and me? Praise God for the Holy Ghost. Praise God for the greater one that lives on the inside of us. We understand that the greater one that lives on the inside of us has given us power to overcome him that is in the world. That Antichrist power, the Antichrist spirit, everything that belongs to the realms of the demonic. Just want you to grab a hold of it tonight, this Wednesday night. I mean, people, you got to have more time in the things of God. I want you to imagine this for your life, and then I'm going to close with this. Imagine that there is a balance, and that every day you had a weight, and let's just say it's a 1 gram weight for each hour. And each hour that you spent doing the things that you got to do, absent really of any participation with the Holy Ghost, you put it on one of the plates of that balance. At the end of the day, what would the balance look like? Is your life weighed in the balance and found wanting? Is Christ Jesus first? Are you given a place of the Holy Ghost? And once again, I'm not saying you got to go live in a cave. I'm not saying you didn't quit your job, stay in the living room and pray and read your Bible all day. It'd be good. I'm saying you've got to understand how to plaster Jesus all over your life. You've got to understand how to begin the day in the Holy Ghost and end the day in the Holy Ghost. You're going to have to learn how to, at midday. There was a place I had at the work that I was at, and this place I worked at, Hybertech, and they had all windows. The whole building was windows. And so at prayer time, I had one or two places that I could go. I could go in the car, which was hot, even when the windows were rolled down in summer. Or I could go out behind the building and kneel down and be a spectacle. Everybody's, what is he doing out in the dirt? But when you find that it's not about religion, it's not about trying to prove anything to anybody, but it's about your consecration to the Lord. I mean, I'm just searching for a place to go. You can find your lunch hour to be an amazing time. You know, I was called so many times to go different places near my work at lunch and not spend my time stuffing my face and talking about, you know, Trump or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Nonsense. But recognize there were so many places I could go and talk to people about Jesus. So many times at lunchtime. I mean, because I had UCSD right near me. I had La Jolla Village, when you could still preach without getting shut down inside 2 minutes. But you still got a two-minute window to preach in La Jolla Village. Town center, you got 2 minutes. You just got to look at where the security guards are. Go to the other end. You got 2 minutes. You can get a lot done. Because the word goes forth. When it comes out of a full heart. Not, you don't have to do it. It's a full heart, man. You burden for the lost. There's a love of God compelling you. I had the beach. And, of course, it didn't matter. I mean, you go in the anointing. I've gone down to the beach at lunchtime to minister to people. I had amazing, so many different amazing things happen. I remember one day I was walking along and I had different pamphlets in my hand just because I was waiting on the Lord and just to direct me, to lead me to someone. And there was this woman that had the most skimpy bikini of anybody on the place. And the Spirit of the Lord so put it on my heart to go to her. Pretty radical, eh? And her daughter was there. It wasn't in no time. This woman's reaching for clothes. Why? Because the Holy Ghost conviction was there. There's no question in my heart. Though she didn't respond to an altar call right there, there's no question in my heart. She's walking with the Lord Jesus today. There's no question in my heart. Because when you're led that way and the word goes forth, come on. Hallelujah. People, there's ways. There's ways. I'm telling you. No one told me to do this. No one preached a sermon to me. I was hid away in glory. I was touched by the Lord. I was apprehended for the kingdom of God. And I didn't allow myself to become entangled with the world and my own stuff. And I'm just asking you tonight. I'm asking you tonight in conclusion. Just asking tonight. Would you consider bearing the body of his death in your body, the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, the death of the Lord Jesus Christ in your body, that the life of Jesus Christ might also be revealed? Would you consider would you consider moving beyond where you're at? Because Father's got something far more for you. So God's Father's got something far more. Somebody said, what am I going to do? All you have to be willing to do is to go after him for it. Spend more time with him. In other words, seek him. Because he's a rewarder of those who seek him. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. For they that come to God. And this is faith. See, this describes faith. Faith knows that God is right here, right now. Faith knows that God is, or that he exists. That to be word. He exists. He is. That's what faith does. And that he's a rewarder of those who seek him. Honestly, just follow me. I'm telling you, just do this kind of stuff. Just do it. Get real with it. You don't have to wait a bunch of years. You can do it right now. I was walking around my room last night going, Lord, I know you in here. Please, reveal yourself to me. Let me see you. I know you're here. And he wasn't hiding from me. I knew he was there. I just couldn't see him visibly. Lord, I want to see you. I'm like chasing him around the room kind of thing. Lord. And obviously, he could have been over in the corner while I'm walking around in circles. I'm the blindfolded guy. Lord, I know you're here. Just reveal yourself to me. Why not do it? Why not go ahead and make God real? Because he is real. Why not go and make him the living, present God who's living in you and walking in you, who loves you dearly? Then you won't have all hindrances. Because when you begin to know and believe the love that he has for you, you can begin to love him back. Ooh. But you'll never love him as much as he loves you. Never. You'll never catch up with him. You'll never love him as much as he loves you. You'll never love him as much as he loves you. You'll never try to wrap your heart around it, because I'm telling you right now, you'll never get your head wrapped around it. You just talk to the Holy Ghost like this. Say, Holy Ghost, I want to feel you right now.
Move in me, Holy Ghost. Lord, I want to touch you. I want to see you. Don't make God something other than the Bible describes him to be. He doesn't describe him to be a God somewhere far away, but here, present, right now, living, walking, dwelling in you. Let him be at your right hand. Joshua, let the Lord be always at your before you. And at your right hand that you should not be moved. Why? Because the Holy Ghost has come to reveal Jesus. He's come to show us that he's before us. And then what will happen is when you go into the throes of great temptation, where the enemy comes to try to claim you and says, I know how to make you my slave. I know how to make you bow before me. You got wisdom. You go, I'm not bowing. I'm not bowing to you today. Or any day from here on. Now it doesn't become just a thought in your mind, an opportunity, a concept of a choice. Now it's what it really is. It's a war. It's a battle for your place in the kingdom. It's a battle for your soul. Do you hear me? I'm talking about the last days and the intensity of the way things, the way that the iniquity shall abound. And because the iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. I'm telling you about the last days where seducing spirits and doctrines of devils so impact men, they become lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. I don't want you to feel ashamed or see a shame, or what I do want you to feel and see and understand is a call and a divine purpose and a divine ability and a divine strengthening and empowerment. And I want you to be able to see how you can lay hold of him, begin to walk with him. I want you to begin to see how he's going to tell you get stuff out of your life. We were sitting around the other day. I was sitting at the table and I cried out. I said, honey, we've got to get right. We got to get things right. The Lord's about to come. Because I don't care where you walk with the Lord in the Holy Ghost, there's a consecration and a call to holiness that creates an urgency about obedience. There's an urgency about the day and the time. Somebody said, oh, don't you see how Paul really missed it? He thought he was going to be alive when Jesus came. No. The Holy Ghost produces an urgency as though it's tonight. It's tonight. It's tonight. It's tonight. It's tonight. It's right now. There's no more time to delay. When I first gave my life to the Lord, and you know, one of the things that, I mean, when I first consecrated my life to the Lord and just totally gave it over to the Lord to be used by him, I would just go where the big centers of where all the party was going down. You know, where the people are riding around in the cars, dropping people off, picking them up. You know, the big bars where all of the crazy stuff is going on, right? And I just stand there. And many times people open the door and I'd hop in the car, shut the door. And I never had a time where anybody said, what are you doing? Trying to kick me out. Say, you know, I just get in the car and say, hey, what's up? Let me tell you about something. Let me tell you about Jesus. You don't have to live your life like this. And just watch the power of God. I mean, those are glory days. I spent so much time on, and then when I moved to San Diego, this was back before I came to San Diego. And then I moved to San Diego, and I found places around San Diego to do the same thing. I mean, because look, in him, there's no shame. There's no fear. There's just radical boldness. The way the Lord would strategically set it up down on Broadway, 6th Avenue, or places in La Jolla, or wherever, Pacific Beach, or wherever, Mission Beach, or wherever people were just doing it. Huh? Stand right everywhere everybody's
passing the hooch, smoking on the weed. And when it goes by, just let it go by. Say, hey, guys, I want to tell you about something. I'll tell you about the power of the living God. You're feeling the power right now. It's something else. Let me tell you about Jesus. Come on. You do these things, don't you? It's fun. You know what? All your troubles go away. And you're ruined for life.
You start doing this stuff, you're ruined for life. You're just like,
I was thinking back in those days, I would literally tattoo a cross on my forehead to see how it impact people. And the Lord told me I couldn't. One of the great missionaries of the late 1800s, he wore a helmet with a big cross on the front of it everywhere he went. Just had this helmet. God used him so radically from South America to China. He just lived his life going everywhere, walking, preaching, telling people, just walking. Started at the border, just walks out. Just living a life for Jesus. Does that sound fun? Come on, man. Does that sound like the life? You're not worried about food. You're not worried about clothes. You're not worried about sparkly things, little shiny stuff, chocolate, special makeup, massage, whatever else you girls get, pedicures and whatever, manicures and need to be cured. I'm telling about the life, man. I'm telling you about the life. I'm telling you, it takes you somewhere. It takes you somewhere in the kingdom. I'm telling you, it takes you somewhere in relationship. It's not works. It's just living out the life. And as you live out the life, your eyes are open. You begin to participate with really what's going on in the realms of heaven rather than being constantly oppressed and imprisoned by the stuff. And you just kind of look through the bars longing for the day. Almost that bad. Praise God, it isn't that bad. You get a little bit of freedom on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Not here. I know that you guys live for Jesus all the time. You're giving yourself over to the Holy Ghost to continually drink of the water, to continue to, woo, pokuda, rasapaya. To where when you think about vacation, we're thinking about, you know, vacation right now, and I'm just like, oh God. Ann and I, when we go to the ranch, it's like, oh God, just as long as I get to spend more time in you and with you, I don't want to get distracted with nothing. Don't let me get distracted. I just want you, Lord. I want to be about your business. I want to be doing what you want me to do. I'm done with me. I'm done. I don't need the stuff. I know where the celebration is. I know where the party is. It's reaching the lost. It's proclaiming his name. It's flowing in the Holy Ghost to see people set free, loosed. John was telling me, I don't know if John's watching right now. If you are, I love you very much. But he's saying, hey, man, we got this guy that's going to start, wants to start paying for crusades. And we're going to start seeing that happen. And then we're going to be able to just, we're going to start being able to hit all of these amazing places that have never seen come right between Bhutan and Nepal. When we do that crusade, people, I'm telling you right now, heaven's going to come to earth. We're going to ship people. Eastern Nepal is a stronghold, a bastion of religion, and then West Bengal, which is right below that, which is also unreached people of the Himalayas, and then Bhutan, and we're going to go, and we're going to spend lots of money hauling people in, bussing people in, getting them there, feeding them, just started the meeting in the morning and taking it through the night. This is the life now, I'm telling you right now. You know where that began? Standing in front of those bars, hopping in those cars. Hey, what's up? They thought I was a dope dealer. That's what, because my hair was long. They thought I was a dope dealer. I was in. Hey, what's up? Jesus, powerful name. And that was never, honestly, it's a fun life. I want you to get out of your nervousness. I want you to get out of your sense of apprehension. Come on, man. I want you to get so lost in the glory, you so drunk in the Holy Ghost, you don't even know what you're doing. Get so drunk in the Holy Ghost, you look like those folks at the bar. You're looking like those people that are standing around outside with these eyes so sad, and you know they're right at the verge of killing themselves. They're so empty. They're so empty. Especially the ones that peripherally stand more or less a little bit off, away from everybody else, kind of alone, or maybe just one or two. They're kind of like outcast kind of things. Beat honey. You know what? I could easily go back to doing that. The Lord has me doing other things. I could go back to doing it. But what are you doing? Because I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not doing that or something like that, you're living a boring life. If you're living a boring life, no wonder you're walking around with a handkerchief and upset and sad. Come on. Dad used to have David and Geneva with a bus, and they'd park out in front of the bars and had donuts and coffee. What a thing to be serving. But I mean, they go net them. They go and blasting the gospel right there. People doing all their stuff. Word of God going for it. Seed going for it. That's fun stuff. Believe me, dear people, there's a way to do this and have fun. There really is. Just get down on your face before the Lord. It's where I learned how to prophesy. Come on, man. You know, for us, especially those guys that are musicians, there was never a platform where people were playing music that I didn't get out there and get the guitar. It's someplace. Got a song for you. I've had the whole bar singing "Just As I Am" with that one plea. Whole nightclub singing. Think about it. It's fun. You have to be clean escape for none of that stuff can even touch you. Huh? And back when I would do it, I didn't tell anybody because I didn't want anybody following me there. Because people try to go with me where they can't go. And then, you know, end up meeting somebody, you know, one thing after another. But you guys are surely you're fenced with iron. Huh? Like the knights of old, fenced with iron. Amen. No sword could pierce you. No spear could. Huh? Thank you, Jesus. Just give me some time to think about what you're going to do in the kingdom. I just want everybody to know in here tonight, I don't care how many times you tripped up, failed, messed up. Christ Jesus wants to get you caught up. And as soon as you begin to allow the things of the Spirit to become big to you, I'm going to tell you all the stuff, the garbage of this world will be of no value. When you start walking around filled up, you'll have no room for anything else. You're just filled up. When you're so filled up, it's gushing out. Somebody comes along and asks you if you want something. Like, yeah, I can't see it's gushing, man. I'm gushing. Woo. Well, I'm about to talk myself into doing it all over again. Amen. Well, just pray. Let's just pray and believe God that effectual doors will be opened unto us. You begin to understand. You'll let God. Listen, I did what I did because it was giant. It was exploding on the inside of me. I was erupting with these things, man. It was just like no one. It's like, once again, no one told me. No one's got to tell you to do it. Get out on your face. I will tell you, I spend a lot of time fasting and praying. I will tell you that. I will tell you, I spend it. And I will also tell you that I was in school. Okay? So I had a very busy schedule. I had all the excuses not to. All the reasons why. You know what? But I discovered that even when I was working, I discovered that most of the people that you could reach were on Friday nights and Saturday nights out on the streets after 8 o'clock. And from 8 o'clock at night till 2 in the morning, it's wide open. Ooh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, the Lord will give you wisdom. He'll give you a vision. Just go after it. If you do it, if you occupy yourself with the things of the kingdom, I'm telling you right now, the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. This is what I want for you. This is what I believe in God for you. You won't have it till you do. I just want you to know, so I want you to understand this right now. Until that critical point comes in your life, it's still going to be uncertainty, and you're still going to be washed back and forth, up and down. But if you'll take a hold of God, man, if you'll just take a hold of God, if you just move on in, if you just move on into this realm, if you just get excited, get happy about God, don't feel like an outcast, don't feel like a loser, don't feel like you're left out, don't feel like you're not measuring up, forget all that mess, because all that's going to do is keep you out. It's going to keep you out of the joy. It's going to keep you from hearing his voice. Don't listen to those voices anymore, those loud voices of the condemner, of the accuser. Just shut that stuff down. Turn the channel. Look at it. You know what I'm saying? Look at the thing and say, I'm glad you're on the radio so I can turn the channel. I just stand here and listen to you. Amen. Amen. Whew. Praise God. I hope everybody's so full of joy. So full of life. Whew. So full of life. Abundant life. The God kind of life. Amen. Well, I want you to come and worship the Lord with your offerings, with your giving. It's just something we do. It's an act of worship. It's something we do. Something God wants us to do. Everywhere you read in the Word of God that he describes something that he wants you to do, do it. Do it. I mean, if you got a quarter and that's all you got, that's fine. That's fine. And you can believe God that just take it to a dollar. Take that dollar to take it on up as he blesses you. And you give as God blesses you. Hallelujah. I know some of you, basically, I understand. There was a time where the church was full of nothing but students, and I was a student too. And there was no sense of receiving an offering. Everybody's money was something that their parents gave them, and it wasn't enough. And then there came a time where we're still students, and we stepped up and said, you know what, we could go ahead and do this. We could go without food or something to do this. And then the Lord just took it to where we are today. Look at where we are today. Amen? Amazing. I just want you to find, listen, you're going someplace good. You get excited about it. You're going someplace good. Your destination is good. And for the majority of people in here, right now, 60, 70 years, you will have crossed over. I plan on crossing over soon. I mean, if the Lord wanted to keep me around, if he wants to keep me around longer, for some reason, that's fine. But I'm sooner rather than later. I'm just ready to cross over into that other realm. Breathe out my last breath. Lay down this body. Let it wait until the trumpet of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. It's going to go by quickly for you. We want you to be blessed. I want you to be blessed. I want you to be received in his presence with exceeding joy. So practice it. Are you with me? You're to be received into his presence with exceeding joy. Practice it. Because When we know and believe the love that God has for us, God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Herein shall we have boldness of the day of judgment. For as he is, so are we right now in this world. Isn't it amazing? Just start telling yourself that. Bathe yourself in the Word of God. Bathe yourself in the things of the Spirit of God. Watch what happens. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. If anybody here tonight needs prayer, you want prayer for anything, anything at all, sickness in your body, torments in your mind, whatever. We're here to pray with you and for you. We know that the Lord will touch you because he's promised to do so. He's present with us. He's anointed us for this cause. He's put the gifts of healing in his church. Hallelujah, this is his church. He's put miracles here. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
David, what you want? What's up?
One more, Jesus.
Really, what you're saying is you just want to know him more. And that's good. That's what he's purposed. So, that's what he wants. He wants that more than you. So the key word is participate. In the mighty name of Jesus. Key word is just flow in the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Ghost has come to reveal him and make him known. Hallelujah. Father, I ask you to show David how easy it is to walk with you. How wonderful it is to be about the Father's business. To be about the Master's business. How wonderful it is, oh God, to find ourselves walking with you every day. Walking with you in obedience. Walking with you in doing the will of the Father. Walking with you, Lord, in honoring you. And being about those things which you yourself are doing. And there we find ourselves coming to know you in the same way we would come to know anyone else. Make this so real, I pray, Father, in Jesus' name. What is it that you want the Lord to do?
I want to know him more.
Okay. Okay. That's good. What's your name?
I'm Ryan.
Ryan. Father, thank you for the anointing. Ryan, did I get it right?
Ryan. Yeah, you got it.
Ryan, got it. Not Ryan, but Ryan. Holy Spirit, show Ryan how to lay himself before you upon an altar and be a living sacrifice. The fire of the Holy Ghost consumes him continually with your presence, with those expressions that only you give, with the promise of the Father, with the realms of heaven. Father, may Ryan be able to see first and foremost what wonders it is to walk with you, and then be able to show it everybody around him. The power of the Ghost. Out of the scripture said, out of your belly, Ryan, shall flow rivers of the Holy Ghost. Rivers of living water, the spake he of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for he was not yet glorified, but being glorified and exalted the right hand of the Father, and having received the promise of the Father, poured forth that which took place when suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and cloven tongues of fire came and rested upon each one of them, and they all began to speak with these utterances of the Spirit as the Holy Ghost spoke through them. Mandayastapoya, the sound of heaven, the sound of heaven, the sound of the redeemed, the sound. Sound of life and celebration. Bako, bako si mambranda paya. Bakromon si si kataya. As a well of water exploding with the issues of water. Moshe gata imasata. From this day forward, in Jesus' name, everything that would try to block your entrance removed by the power of the living God, seem to step over into the flow of heaven. I command blessing upon you in Jesus' mighty name. Ida Borastai, Le Mandaristo. Let not the inhabitants of the Lord say I'm sick, but bless and praise him for his healing power, for his redeeming power, Dorabastate, Bandubo, for his strengthening power. Jesus. Out of your belly flows. Just remember, out of your belly.
No matter where you are, you can draw water from the well. No matter where you are, you can get a drink, because he's made you a well of salvation. Hallelujah. No matter where you are, there's a supply of heaven. And with joy,
With joy shall they draw water. With joy. With joy and with thanksgiving. Now the Lord doesn't want you to come disappointed to church ever again. Upset or feeling bad because of the things that have happened around you. No. I mean, you can, but he didn't want you to. Because you can touch heaven, right? You can touch heaven 1 second after a discouraging situation. You can be overwhelmed with the joy of the Lord 1 moment after a bunch of depressing things hit you. Huh? You get a report that all your kids were in a house and the roof collapsed and they're all dead. And then right after that, all your herds died. And all this stuff. And you can still just be saying, I rejoice in the Lord. Paul said, in all my tribulation, I'm exceeding glad. You know what creates that? Relationship. Just knowing him in a greater way. Amen.
Thank you, Father, for your divine provision. Thank you, Father. Urasataya moshe kande e prisho ye nashe to tarne pota. Riboshe pedeya poshinda te epitano. Zozande lopote risate kushing bote chesusa. Just open up your hearts and let the floodgates of heaven flow out of you. Let the things of heaven that God has supplied, that is freely given, be received by you. And watch as Father begins to do a new thing as you participate with that he's been doing since the day that Jesus received the promise of the Father. Just receive right now. Just receive right now. Hallelujah. Just receive right now. That wonderful realm of his joy and that wonderful realm of the Holy Ghost that begins to supply faith and divine ability. Hallelujah. Moje. Just receive. Moje. Moze banane. Mosta. Merina namasiti. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for heaven's provision. Right now. Harisita satakishi. Harima no siddhiti shikata dust. Harisatanish. Jesus. Jesus. Ridonastea. Thank you, Father, right now. Right now in Jesus' name. The only things that can stop you are those things that you allow to stop you. Hallelujah. Havrana say. Havrana say. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for heaven's provision. Rabaso, Ranembeki Rambo Shiplai. Isat.
That's it. Just receive right now from heaven. Just receive right now from heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Heaven's glory flood your soul.
Jesus' name. Every organ, every part. functions with the life and the glory of God. Thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
That all your promises, oh God, that all the things, oh God, that you do in our midst will never cease to exist. Thank you, Father, for the working of miracles. Yes, the healing.
Yes, Lord.
Now, Jesus. Fire, Holy Ghost. The fire, the Holy Ghost, the rest, and the peace. The fire, the Holy Ghost. In the la bosta, beretis fra. In the la bosta, berevista, televista fra. Just let that bottle, I say, right out of your belly. Bro Satan. Just say, beristando lo boku kina makea. Bombrasaya, libre mandu, stifrete, pufratasi. Yeah, Bremostan. Somebody said, oh, teaching how to speak in tongues. No, I'm teaching what the Holy Ghost taught me. I can't let you repeat something the Holy Ghost gave me. What's wrong with that? Huh? You watch out. You get up here and interfacing with the things that the servant of the Lord says to do, and you find yourself step right into something new. Amen. Just by obeying. The word is precipitate. No, it's participate.